Hi there, Pastor Caleb here with Oasis Community Church. I just wanted to welcome you and say that I'm so grateful and glad that we are able to communicate together through this medium. Technology today is a phenomenal thing and it can be a great blessing to our lives. One comment before we get to the message that you came here looking for. In Acts chapter 2, verse 42, the writer tells us that the early church met together not only for hearing the gospel preached through the teaching of the apostles, but also for the breaking of bread and for fellowship and for prayer. And the reality is, the implication of that is that these other ways that we participate in worship, we participate in our faith, are actually just as important as hearing the word of God preached. So I want to encourage you, if you're using these videos online as anything but a supplement to your daily walk with a community of believers, then I just want to encourage you to please think about attending church on Sunday morning. Whether that's here with us at Oasis Community Church or anywhere else, it is so important for you to find a local body of believers, people that you can break bread with, that you can fellowship with. We want to be able to pray for you, and we would love to have your prayers for us. And as a brief benediction for today's message as you watch this sermon today, I just want to ask the Lord that the words of our mouths and the meditations of our hearts would be pleasing in the sight of our Lord Jesus Christ, our Rock and our Redeemer, and that the words you're about to hear would make a profound impact on your life, your faith, and your fellowship with a God who loves you so dearly. In the name and honor of our Lord Jesus Christ, amen.
I think so.
So I actually wasn't very close to my father. My parents divorced right before I turned 10, and I moved up to California with my mom. My dad stayed in Arizona. But I was very, very fortunate at a young age to be a part of a church community where several older men in our community sort of took me under their wing, and they kind of became father figures to some extent in my life. So I'm going to tell you guys about a couple of them this morning. First, if we can go to the first image, guys, this is, let's see if it works. We had some technical difficulties this morning, so. The guy over there, right next to me, I got the mushroom hair. That's high school right there. The guy with the big O hands, his name's Dale Soshevsky. He was the area director for Young Life in Paradise, California, where I come from. If you've heard of Young Life, they reach out to unchurched high school kids, which was me, right? So because of this man and his ministry, I owe much of the reality today that I have given my life to Jesus and I'm a part of the church. But he went way beyond that for me, right? Dale actually gave me opportunities to serve and to grow that I wouldn't normally have had without him, right? He actually would come and give me rides just so I could be at church to learn and to grow and to serve. So Dale was a huge impact on my life. And believe it or not, when I was young, I made some mistakes.
No, never happened.
Not you.
And guess who was there to help me pick up the pieces every time I made a mistake?
He was.
Dale was. Even when those mistakes actually hurt him. And that's something that I could never be more grateful in my life. So that's Dale. The next man I want to tell you about. Does anyone have someone in their lives that loves them enough to tell them when they're being an idiot?
Yeah.
You should, right? I hope you do.
Yes.
This gentleman who also doesn't have hair, Bill, you got another one in the family here. This is Doug Wyan and his family. His older boys were actually friends of mine in high school. They ended up becoming my roommates in college. And Doug was our landlord. He also was an elder at our church. And Doug was that guy in my life who wasn't afraid, who loved me enough to tell me when I was being an idiot. And his caution helped me avoid so many mistakes that I could have made in life, right? But if you've ever been young, which all of you have, you also know that you don't always listen to the voice of reason, do you? So when I didn't listen to his advice, and I ended up regretting it after the fact, guess who was there to help me pick up the pieces every time?
He was.
Even when I wouldn't listen to what he said. Doug was still there to help me pick up the pieces. Without these two men, I simply wouldn't be who I am today, as imperfect as I am. So today, we actually are coming to the last section of 1 Peter, chapter 5. And what you're going to find there is Peter is having to deal with a reality. He is getting up there in age. The people who were with him, who saw Jesus crucified on the cross, are getting up there in age. And they didn't think that they were going to pass away on this earth before Jesus came back. They most likely thought that Jesus was going to show up before they ever had to experience death. And now that he's getting up in age, he's realizing that there's still a task that him and his generation need to accomplish. And if they don't do it right, it could create a lot of strife, a lot of conflict in the church. So that's what we're going to be looking at today. If you have your Bibles, open them up to 1 Peter chapter 5. We're looking at verses 1 through 5 this morning. And as you can see, they'll be on the screen here. Here's what he says. So I exhort the elders among you, as a fellow elder and a witness of the suffering of Christ, as well as a partaker in the glory that is going to be revealed. Shepherd the flock of God that is among you, exercising oversight, not under compulsion, but willingly, as God would have you. Not for shameful gain, but eagerly. Not domineering over those in your charge, but being examples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the unfading crown of glory. Likewise, you who are younger, be subject to the elders. Clothe yourselves, all of you, with humility toward one another. For God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Now, the Greek word that they're using here for the term elder is the word presbyteros. Presbyteros is a word that was most often used for a positional leadership in the church, right? Here at Oasis, we have a group of men who are elders, and they're Bill's boss, and therefore they're my boss, right? They're here to help oversee the church community. So often this word is used in that way. However, it also simply means elder as in older in age, right? So if you have two sons, one of them is going to be the presbyteros, or the elder son, unless you have twins, of course, and the other is going to be the younger son. Now the question becomes, in this passage, which one is Peter talking about? Is he simply talking about people who are in a position of leadership in a church community? Or is he talking about, generally speaking, those who are older in age? My simple answer to you is yes to both. Let's talk about why. We can tell that Peter's talking about those who are generally older in age because of who he contrasts with the elders at the end of the passage, right? He doesn't contrast or juxtapose believers or members or disciples in a general sense, right? No, instead, the group that he juxtaposes are younger people, right? Which seems to imply that he's talking about an older generation in the church. We also see Peter call attention to one, his own age, as a fellow elder, but also he says, and a witness to the sufferings of Christ. You see, Peter was there when Jesus was captured by the high priest. Peter was there when they beat Jesus. When they had the Roman trial and Pontius Pilate let Barabbas go and Jesus got sentenced to crucifixion. And then he was there when Jesus carried the cross up the hill, when he was nailed to the cross, when he saw him resurrected, when he ascended into heaven. And Peter is writing to a group of people, some of which were probably also there. A fellow witness to the sufferings of Christ, something that a younger generation simply cannot claim. However, when we read this, we also see that he includes a lot of language referring to leadership, doesn't he? He says, shepherd the flock that is among you, exercise oversight. Then he refers to Jesus as the chief shepherd, chief being a positional authority. See, Peter clearly has leadership in mind as well when he writes these words, and this begs an important question. Those who are wiser in the church, those who have lived more and therefore have experienced more and have a certain knowledge that the younger generation simply doesn't have. What responsibility does that wisdom typically bring with it? And that is leadership. Leadership is a responsibility that typically comes along with wisdom, in the church especially. Those who have the greatest wisdom ought to also be in a position of leadership or have the responsibility to share it. And the way I like to say this to people is, we would much rather be led by those with wisdom or with great wisdom than by those with great energy. Right? We would much rather be led by those with great wisdom than by those with great energy. See, with a lot of energy, we can get a lot of stuff done, can't we? But if you don't have a lot of wisdom in addition to that energy, then you might find yourself doing a lot of the wrong things and wasting a lot of that time and energy. However, when you have less energy, you might do less things, and so you know the importance of doing the right things, don't you? This weekend is one of the biggest golf tournaments of the year, the U.S. Open. I don't get to talk about golf a lot, but I'm taking my chance on Father's Day, right? The U.S. Open, and this year it's at Pebble Beach. Pebble Beach is over in California, and it's perhaps one of the most gorgeous golf courses you've ever seen in your life. Giant cliffs towering over miles of ocean and beaches, and then the humid ocean climate makes that grass thick and green and messy. And I saw something take place while watching the tournament on Thursday that reminded me of this passage. And it took place on the 8th hole at Pebble Beach. Can we get that image up on the screen? It's the pretty one. There it is. Okay. Absolutely gorgeous, right? So if you can see, there's a blue dot all the way at the top of the image. That's where the golfers have to start from on this hole. They have to tee off right there. Then this sort of yellow boxed-in area, that's their first stop to get to the end. They have to hit the ball and land it on the grass in that little square area. And at the end of that square area, what do you have? A cliff, right? You have a cliff. So the object here is to hit it far enough that then you can actually hit your second shot and make it down to the little green at the bottom, but not hit it so far that you roll it off the end of this cliff. And so I'm watching as a couple of older, more experienced players pick the right club, and they hit that ball and land it nice and soft. And they're not worried about clobbering it. They're just worried about getting it safe, because they know that they'd rather hit a longer second shot than risk rolling off the edge of this cliff. Well, then we got Mr. Jordan Spieth coming up to the tee, right? Well, Jordan Spieth is 25 years old, and he's a phenomenal athlete. He's a phenomenal golfer. He's actually won this tournament in the past. He has a lot of energy. And so Mr. Spieth picks up a club, and he hits that ball, and he's trying to hit it as close as he can to that cliff without going off so that he can have a shorter second shot. And what do you think happened? Went right over the edge of the cliff. And so he ended up actually getting a penalty shot and then missing the green and then ended up two strokes behind all of his competitors by the time it's open. Mr. Spieth is a phenomenal golfer, but he's a young golfer. He's an inexperienced golfer. He's impatient. He's a little rash. And in that moment, he could have used the wisdom of older and more experienced players. People who have been on this course and seen this happen before, maybe people who picked the wrong club, tried to hit it too close, and fallen off the edge themselves, right? In the church, those who have the greatest wisdom also have the greatest responsibility to share it. And trust me, we'd much rather be led by those with great wisdom than by those with great amounts of energy, or simply those with greater amounts of energy. If you consider yourself an older person, I have good news for you. Most likely, you have already made it past the majority of the mistakes you're going to make in life. So congratulations. You came out unscathed. That's simply not necessarily the case for others, right? Now, the majority of Peter's statements in this passage actually have to do with motivation, don't they? So the question we have is, what should be the motivating factor that might lead this elder generation Peter's talking to impart wisdom and guidance and leadership to a younger generation? What's the motivating factor? And on this, his point is very clear. Imparting wisdom and guidance through leadership is always done for the benefit of other people, not for our own benefit. And this is the reality he's hinting towards. This church will only outlive you if you serve this church for the sake of those who will outlive you. You see that?
Mm-hmm.
Peter is grappling with a reality here, that there is a younger generation of believers that he thought he was always going to be around the lead. But he's getting older in age, and he's realizing that God might be a bit more patient than he thought, right? God might have a different plan, and all of a sudden these younger people might actually have to step into Peter's shoes. This church will only outlive any of us if we serve it for the sake of those who will outlive all of us. Perhaps the greatest task that any of us will ever complete is one that, frankly, we will never have the pleasure of witnessing the benefits of. And that is imparting wisdom, guidance, and an opportunity to lead to the younger generation that comes after us. Peter goes as far as to link this unfading crown of glory, which, best I can tell, he's alluding to salvation, right? And he's basically saying that at the end of your life, when you're ready for Jesus to come, you're at a point where, you know what? I've lived a good life. I've served the Lord well. I can't wait to go home. He says that sweet, unfading crown of glory is waiting for you, but there's one task left. One task left. And that is to impart wisdom and guidance and an opportunity to disciple a younger generation to step in your stead. So here's what he has to say. The older or elder generation should help guide the younger generations, not under compulsion, but willingly. Do you desire to see those who are younger than you learn and grow? Is that something you desire? Do you want to be around when the younger generation makes mistakes? So that you can be there to help them pick up the pieces. Do you want to build relationships with the generations beneath you so that you can hopefully help prevent them, be a voice of caution in their lives, prevent them from making the same mistakes that you have made? Peter goes on. We should do this not for shameful gain, but eagerly. Is that interesting to you? He contrasts this idea of gaining ourselves with the idea of eagerness. Do you try and guide people who are younger than you so that you can make life easier for yourself? Or are you just as eager to help them as you would be to help you if you were in that position? And this last one, he says, is the most important. Not domineering over those in your charge, but being examples to the flock. You see, leading the church, imparting wisdom, the things that we've learned to the generations that come after us, can only be accomplished in an environment where every generation is operating in humility. It's the only way it works. You cannot pass up on wisdom if, one, people are not willing to share for the other's benefit, and, two, if those who are receiving are not willing to listen. It requires humility. In Philippians, let me see, where did I put this? In Philippians chapter 2, Paul actually deals with the same subject. And he says, humility is to count others more significant than yourselves. Humility is to count others more significant than yourselves. So the question is, can we do this serving other people, not based on what they deserve, but based on an eager desire to see other people exalted above ourselves? This is what it means to impart wisdom and humility. I heard a story once about a school teacher who tried a social experiment. Can I get the last image up on the screen, please, guys? You guys heard of the angle balloon game, right? You basically blow up some balloons, tie them to a string, and you tie them onto the ankle of whoever's playing. And the object of the game is to run around and stomp on and pop everyone else's balloon while simultaneously protecting your own. Right? It's a very fun game. It's an adventure, and it's usually a little ruckus. Well, this teacher, we'll call her Mrs. M, she wanted to see how her students would respond. What kind of social environment would this game create in her classroom? So she took her fourth grade class, a bunch of 10, maybe 11-year-old kids. She tied balloons on their ankles. She explained the rules, and she said, go. And man, they started bumping and stomping and popping everyone's balloons. And by the time it was over, there was one student standing in the middle, the winner, the victor. And who do you think was the most hated student in the class? That student, the one who won, right? Because he had shoved, he had manipulated the environment well enough to protect his own balloon, but stomp on everyone else's. And some people probably got hurt in the process, right? Well, turns out Mrs. M also teaches another class. This class has some students with special needs in it. And so she wanted to see how they would respond to the ankle balloon popping game. And so she tied balloons around all their ankles, and then she explained the rules to them. But she quickly realized, once they started, that they had made the rules unique to their own interpretation, right? Because what she saw was, instead of romping around trying to pop everyone else's balloons, the kids were actually holding their balloons out so their friends could pop them. And then the friends, in turn, were holding their balloons out so they could pop them. They had made the balloons the enemy. And by the time the very last balloon popped, they all cheered and roared in victory together. What a beautiful example.
Amen.
Of humility. Of what it looks like to consider others more significant than yourself. Of what it looks like to exalt other people above yourself. To hold your balloon out. Your opportunity to take charge, perhaps. So that someone else can pop it. So that someone else can win or grow or learn. Here's how I want to drive this home. If you're here this morning and you consider yourself a younger person in the church, if you think there are probably more people in here that are older rather than younger than you are, then listen up, because I'm talking to you. Every single one of the older people in our church have been 18, 25, 35, 40. Not a single one of us has ever been 55, 65, or 70. And that's a reality we have to take to heart. They have seen more than us. They have learned more than us. We still have the majority of our mistakes to make in life, right? My desire for the younger generations in the church and in our church in particular is that we will be humble enough to allow those who have more age and wisdom than we do to guide us and to lead us. That we would have the humility to learn from their teachings about their own mistakes, so we can hopefully prevent ourselves from making the same ones in our own lives. My desire is that every opportunity that we get in this church to promote people into positions of leadership, to make decisions, my prayer is that the younger people in our church would always be looking to promote an older generation in humility. That's my hope. Now, if you consider yourself to be an older person in our congregation, then please allow me to say a few things to you first. Thank you. Thank you for your wisdom, your guidance, and the strength that you have shown to maintain a lifetime of faith-giving people in this world. Literally, people owe their lives to you. I owe my life to your generation. Now allow me to ask you a question. Would you prefer that the younger generations find themselves beginning to take responsibility for this beautiful church before or after you have passed away?
Before.
Probably before. Would you prefer to give younger people an opportunity to lead while you're still around to help them, to guide them, to give them wisdom from the background? My prayer for our older generations is that we would be on the lookout constantly for up-and-coming young people. People who could do great things for the Lord with just a little bit of encouragement, just a little bit of help. My prayer is that when we come to a position, a place where we need to nominate people into leadership positions in our church, my hope is that the older generations would actually be uplifting a younger generation, right?
Amen.
Why? Because you want to see them grow. You want to see them learn, and you want to see them do that while you're still here to help them. When generations divide us, the gospel of Jesus Christ suffers. When generations divide us, the wisdom the Holy Spirit has gifted you throughout your life falls on deaf ears. When generations divide us, we leave young people to suffer mistakes that we could have helped them avoid. One, if we were willing to share, and two, if they were willing to listen. If we can just be humble enough. Whether or not your children are grown and out of the home, there are young people in this community that still need your guidance, and that includes me. As young people, we need the humility to value that guidance as the prized possession that it is. If we allow generations to divide us, my eyes are getting watery here, then what we risk is failing to accomplish our greatest task. Our greatest task, and that is discipling the next generation in the wonderful good news of Jesus, right? So Lord Jesus, I want to pray for humility. And Lord, I want to thank you for the humility that this church has already displayed in welcoming a 29-year-old kid stand up here for clean. Jesus, I thank you for the generation that sits here and has done so much for the gospel in this world. I thank you for Doug, for Dale, for all the men in my life that I simply wouldn't be me without. And I pray that my generation, that a younger generation, would be able to do two things, Lord. One, be humble enough to listen, and to be courageous enough to share our wisdom with the generations that follow us. Lord Jesus, thank you for our fathers, for our mothers, for our grandparents. And we just pray that we wouldn't let generations divide us, and that we would be able to be humble in discipling younger people to take leadership of the church before we're out here. And in your name we pray these things. Amen.